I would like to mention here that some or full content of this session may help you to be a cyber aware, being a cyber savvy, and help you to understand the security concepts while preparing for any cybersecurity exams like CISM, CISA, CISSP, etc. CISM, you can find this in domain 4, which is Information Security Incident Management, and CISSP, you can find under Security Operations.
Build an incident response plan while we strive to protect our systems and information against a wide variety of threats. The reality is that no matter how many controls we put in place, there is a still possibility that we will fail or we will fall victim to a security incident. We must focus on using a standard set of practice endorsed by National Institute for Standard and Technology, that is NIST. If you'd like more information on this process, you can find a complete reference in the NIST Computer Security Incident Handling Guide. It's published online as NIST Special Publication 800-161. And this guide is widely used as a standard reference throughout the cybersecurity field. Every organization should develop a cybersecurity incident response plan that outlines the policies, procedures, and guidelines that the organization will follow. When an incident takes place, this process is extremely important because it provides structure and organization in the heat of crisis. I have been involved in many security incidents, friends, over the course of my career. And when I think back and evaluate them, in it's clear to me that all of the organizations that handle incident will had one thing in common. They had clearly thought through their incident response process and document in an advance of the incident. On the other hand, when I think about incidents that did not go very well, they typically occurred in organizations that do not conduct prior planning. In those organizations, I commonly heard the sentiment, well, we are going a crisis management and a security incident is not very likely. We'll figure out the detail if it happens. This approach of cybersecurity incident is a perfect recipe of failure, because the reality is that people make bad decisions in the heat of a crisis. Developing an incident response plan in advance of an incident taking place allow you to make decisions in a calm environment of the planning phase. And those decisions then help you exercise good judgment in the heat of security incident. A formalized incident response plan should include several common elements. First, it should begin with a statement of purpose. That's very important. Friends, if somebody is preparing for any cybersecurity exam, you have to understand very first thing. Even I'm just adding other than this slide, I just thought to add because that comes immediately in my mind. If somebody is preparing for any cybersecurity exam, even especially writing a business case, the very first thing should come into mind is the need. If need is clear, half things will be done. The half things is finance, but there are some more things that should consider consider while writing the business cases. But need is at most important. So first thing, it should begin with a statement of purpose. What are the reasons that organization is creating an incident response plan, and what is the scope of that plan? What type of incident does the plan cover? For example, is the plan restricted to only cybersecurity incident, or will it cover any loss of sensitive information as well? Second, the plan should describe clear strategies and goal for the incident response effort. What are the highest priority for first responder and those handling an incident at a more strategic level. If responder should prioritize containment over evidence preservation, make sure that's clearly mentioned in the plan. The plan should also describe the nature of the organization's approach to incident response. Who bears the responsibility for incident handling? And what authority do they have? Your incident response plan should cover communication within the team, with other group, within the organization, and with third parties. We'll talk more about the incident communication process later in this slide. And finally, the plan should include the approval of senior management. That is absolutely mandatory. Without this, whatever the plan you have, it's not going to work, that's for sure. You might need that authority when taking unpopular actions during incident response. If you can point to the plane and show an administrator that the policy requires disconnection of a system was signed by the CEO, that's going a long way. Friends, as you develop your plan, you should definitely consult NIST Special Publication 800-161. This will help you. This is a guide which helps you for taking any decision. You can just search NIST Special Publication 800-161. You will get this. This is PDF widely available. I think in my upcoming slide, I have mentioned the link also. I forget to mention here, but you will be getting the link in my upcoming slides. Next is incident communication plan. One of the critical components of your incident response plan is communication plan that covers both internal and external communication. Those procedures help ensure that the appropriate people within your organization know about an incident at the right time, and thus they are provided with accurate information. Communicating with individuals and group outside of your organization can be much trickier task. You want to make sure that you are limiting the communication of sensitive information to trusted parties only. This is particularly important when there might be public or media interest in an incident. If words leak out without approval, the incident might wind up in the news before your public relation team is ready to handle it. This might also jeopardize the integrity of your investigation by alerting the attackers to the fact that you have discovered the incident and that an incident response effort is underway. In most cases, you are not under a legal obligation to report security incident. To law enforcement, and decision to do so is complex. Once you file a report with law enforcement, it's likely that the detail of incident will become public, which may be undesirable. Also, law enforcement officials are held to much higher standard in gathering and processing evidence. Of course, you should always contact law enforcement if you think there is a threat to safety or you have a legal obligation to report a specific kind of incident. Your legal team should be included in your incident response planning effort, and they should provide with specific guidance about any law or regulation that apply to your organization and may require notification in the event of a security incident. For example, most states have privacy law on the books that require the timely notification of individuals when there is a compromise of personal information. You also may have obligation under other law and regulation to notify government agencies, private regulation bodies, customers, or the public about a specific type of incident depending on the impact and type of information involved. Your communication plan should not only describe who you will communicate with during an incident, but should also describe how you will communicate. Make sure that you have secure communication channel in place before an incident occurs. This will provide you with a security mechanism to share information with trusted employees and with third parties. Using secure channel is prevent. Using secure channel prevents the inadvertent release of information to public or to the advertisers, as we mentioned a few moments back. Incident identifications. Friends, once you have an incident response plan in place and a team prepared, the incident response process that enters a state of monitoring, watching for signs that an incident is taking place or has already occurred. There are many different ways that an organization might identify a security incident. The key to successful incident identification is having a robust security monitoring infrastructure. Data is crucial to incident detection, and organizations have a responsibility to collect, analyze, and retain security information. There are many different sources that may contribute data critical to identification and analyzing a possible security incident. These incident intrusion detection and prevention system, firewall, authentication system, system integrity monitoring, vulnerability scanner, system event log, NetFlow connection records, and anti-malware packages, amongst many other sources. If IT system do one thing well, is generating a massive amount of log information. Security professionals are responsible for collecting and correlating this information. Unassisted, that almost an impossible undertaking. Fortunately, security incident and event management, or SIEM, technologies can assist with this task. SIEM systems act as centralized log repository and analysis solution. Security professionals can take the firewalls of data they receive from security-related logs and point them to SIEM, which then do a heavy lifting and analysis work. SIEM system may detect possible incident based upon rules and algorithms, bringing them to the attention of security administrator for further review. They also provide a critical centralized information source to investigators pursuing a security incident. We have, friends, just talked about many of the way that a security team might identify incident based upon the internal generated data. And in the best case, that's the way we detect incident. But noticing the sign of an incident as it occurs or shortly thereafter, unfortunately, some of these monitoring systems fail to detect an incident. And we first learn of a security compromise by hearing from employees, customers, or external organization who see the sign of a breach. This might occur when a customer sees his or her personal information posted on a web. When a system on the corporate network begins attacking an external site due to command received from a botnet, or when an employee notices that he or she cannot log in an email account, the incident response team should have a consistent method for receiving, recording, and evaluating these external reports. When a security professional identifies a potential incident, it's time to swing into incident response mode. The team member who first notices an incident and other who may be on duty have a special first responder responsibility. Just as in a medical emergency, the first person on the scene has the ability to have a tremendous impact on a successful response to an incident by acting quickly and to protect the organization. first responder should act quickly to contain the damage from the security incident. If they suspect that a system or group of a system may compromise, the first responder should immediately isolate that system from the rest of the network to contain the damage. Now, depending upon the technical circumstances, first responder may quarantine the system by removing it from the network, keeping it running to preserve the evidence by cutting off the potential compromised system's ability to communicate with attackers or infect other systems on the corporate network, effectively quarantining it. This is a favorite topic of security exam, friends. So you should understand that. You remember, a first responder's highest priority should be containing the damage by isolating affected systems. Escalations and notifications. When a security professional detects a potential incident, they should immediately swing into first responder mode, acting to isolate affected system and contain the damage caused by the incident. As soon as they have handled the immediate emergency, they should move into incident escalation and notification process. The escalation and notification process has several important objectives. First, it evaluates the severity of the incident based upon the incident's potential impact on the organization's security. Second, it escalates the incident to an appropriate level of incident response. Finally, it notifies management and other stakeholders of the incident and plan to resolve it. Now, after containing an incident, the responder should begin a triage. Now, triage process that identifies the potential impact of the incident. The process for rating incident severity should be found in the organization incident response procedure. One common scheme uses a three-tiered scale of low impact, moderate impact, and high impact incident. Let's go one by one. First, low impact incident have minimal or no potential to affect the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of the information or system belonging to the organization. In low impact incident, the first responder would normally attempt to resolve the incident themselves and wait to call in additional resources or perform notification until the incident escalates or is resolved. Low impact incident would not normally call for an after hour responses. Moderate impact incident. Moderate impact incidents are more likely to have a significant impact on the organization's security posture. The occurrence of a moderate level incident normally triggers the full or partial activation of incident response team and prompt notification of management. High impact incident. High impact incident may cause critical damage to an organization and justify an immediate full response. Senior executive should be immediately notified and the entire incident response team should be mobilized. Member not needed for the immediate response should be informed that an incident response is underway and placed on standby status. So in short, there is a involvement of complete team, either that is required or not. Those which are not must be on a standby. Now, the notification and escalation process will vary from organization to organization. But the common theme is that this process must be clearly throughout and have appropriate tools in place. At a minimum, first responder should have access to the mobile phone number of anyone who may need to notify. Organization may choose to put in place a technology solution that automate the team response.